The 16-foot-long aquarium's main framework is basically done. And you guys know me. I had to get my wood in it. I just wanted to see what it was going to look like, and I realized that I don't really have as much wood as I thought I did. 16 feet of escape is going to be rather challenging. However, the most challenging part of this build was deciding how I was actually going to design this in the first place. We're going to have to go back 12 years. One of the biggest things when building a plywood aquarium is if it's going to flex once filled with water. You can see this. Obviously, the entire bracing isn't complete. We'll get to that in a minute. But we want to consider a couple of factors. If this were to explode, where is it going to explode from? A lot of the times, the seams on a plywood aquarium are so beefy that it's typically never going to happen. It's usually going to spread at the top because you don't have enough top bracing or proper materials, causing the tank to either split completely apart and or that flexing can cause cracks in the epoxy, the other thing, in the most common area of a leak. And if you've built a plywood aquarium, I've seen where your tanks are leaking from, and I know why. It's the base. Usually, almost every time, a plywood aquarium leaks from around the bottom. Now, I mentioned we have to go back 12 years ago because I built a 540-gallon aquarium using concrete or cinder blocks for the stand. I took apart a couple of 130-gallon tanks using the 6-foot panels to build a big square aquarium. I started from the ground up, and the reasoning is very simple. If I put the plywood down, I actually drilled the bottom of this tank to the stand. So there will be no wobbling, there will be no flexing. So I covered that. So the base is 1.5 inches thick of plywood. From there, the perimeter of the tank, I drilled 2x4s all along it. First one, and then I sandwiched another one on top of that, drilling that into it. That meaning, and I think you guys know what will happen there, absolutely nothing. There's absolutely no amount of pressure that's gonna blow this bottom pieces apart. Just like that 540 gallon I built that out of 2x2s for its perimeter, so that when I have somewhere to not only guide the glass in, but stops it from kind of like buckling apart. Like I said, we're building this from the base up. So once that perimeter was installed, I built the rib work, or the main support structure that's gonna hold the walls in, and then sandwich that on top, and then of course another one up here, but with a bit of a twist. All of the ends here are kind of the same, but if we look down here, we've layered them so that it's never bucking up against each other. They're sitting on top of each other. So this top panel's drilled into the side as well as the front, and then these two are drilled down into the stand, the front and the back being identical. The end pieces are 4 2x4s, all sandwiched, all drilled together. And then as you can see, even more supports with these corner brackets held together with 2.5-inch lag bolts, meaning that these lag bolts not only go through this piece of wood, but through this piece of wood. And of course, that is repeated on every corner. Is it absolutely necessary considering all the extra support that's going in here? No, but it's gonna let me sleep a little better at night. And you guys know that I overbuild everything. A tank that comes to mind that's overbuilt, the most overbuilt that I've ever done, is of course my 2,000 gallon aquarium. I could have built this with 6-inch walls using 2,500, maybe 2,800 PSI concrete. The front panel really only needed to be about 1.25 inches thick. And then epoxy the inside. I could have called it a day, but I went with 8-inch thick, 5,000 PSI reinforced with rebar and a 1.6-inch thick acrylic panel. This tank is literally bulletproof. Acrylic at 1.25-inch thick can typically stop almost any bullet, or any common bullet. I'm Canadian, so I don't know what all bullets do, but I do know that common bullets, I think they're called. one and a quarter inch thick acrylic panel would stop a bullet. Six inch thick concrete typically stops most bullets as well. So this tank is literally bulletproof. It is a permanent structure in here, and so is this new plywood tank. If I ever decide I want to move it, it's going to be next to impossible because all throughout here, the entire tank is drilled into the stand. That won't fit out the window. I'd have to cut it up. I'd have to do something. But a lot of the times when you overbuild something, just know that it's probably going to be a permanent structure. It's probably going to take longer to take it apart if you ever need to than it did to put together. Now, I want to apologize that this did take me so long to do, but I have to be honest, I didn't know how I wanted to build it. I was originally thinking I'll build the frame, but that would include me flipping it over, over and over and over again, trying to put it together. 16 feet long, you guys know I'd build everything myself, alone. Wouldn't have been possible. And that's when that 540 gallon snapped into my head. Go from the bottom up. Worked out perfectly. There are a few other things that we need to do to make this tank hold actual water and or to finish its actual bracing. First and foremost, we're gonna line the entire saw inside with plywood. 3/4 inch. And then we're gonna line the entire outside with plywood. All these seams will be covered. The plywood's gonna go up against every seam, offering a tremendous amount of additional structural support and increase its integrity tenfold. Plywood on materials really, really increases the strength. And then of course the top bracing. I'm not sure exactly how I wanna do it, but I do know I want a center brace. I'll probably make a 10 inch wide center brace from here to there, drilled down into it. And the same over here. So another brace is gonna go here and go across all of the sides as well as the front. I might even use a 2x10 to be honest with you and just go right across. And then of course we can epoxy the inside. And I think now is a good time to tell you what color I bought. Do you guys see where I put my epoxy? I know for a fact I have epoxy. Oh, I know where I put it. I installed some storage over here the other day. In here. Here's part A. Now you can see right here, it'll say sea blue, competition blue. When it comes to the pond armor, I've always used black or white, but I've always really liked the idea of the competition blue. It's like a lightish, it's not too dark, but it's not too light. And the thinking process behind that is that we're only really gonna see the back, right? And I'm hoping or I'm thinking that once it's blue back there, maybe we get a little bit of algae on it. It's just gonna look even more natural while not keeping the tank too dark in appearance. I wanted to kind of brighten it up for the first time of building a plywood tank with that color. I think you guys will like it as well. The front panel, 1 inch thick acrylic, which we already have as well. The only thing that I gotta buy is around three, four sheets of plywood, cut it up, and then I can start epoxying the inside. Once that's done, I can install the front panel. Once that's done, I can brace it. Once that's done, I will make the outside look pretty. I'll probably water test before I make the outside look pretty, although even the outside of it's going to add to the structural integrity. I'm also thinking maybe I'll do brickwork out here, but the entire thing will be blacked out. Outside of it black, inside of it blue. Very exciting. And I'm happy to kind of start moving forward with this. I know that it doesn't look that tall, but this is going to be a long tank that's actually practical. I didn't want it too deep. I don't plan on keeping monster fish. This is going to be one massive community aquarium with relatively small fish. You guys love when I do that. And I don't mean small fish like Oscars and or Severums like that. I mean Ultim Angels, Corydora, Fancy Plecos, Autosynclus, all kinds of fish like that instead. A massive school of Tetras, something really interesting and fun. And of course I got lots of wood. These woods kind of suck, but this one over here is really nice. And then I've got a tremendous amount of more types of wood like this manzanita here. Like a lot more, like a pallet more. So we can really make this look nice. I don't know if I want these big logs in there. I'm not sure. And then we'll probably put in some stone, some white sand. It should end up looking really, really nice. But that is the framework, a basic idea and rundown of how to do it. Honestly, it took about 2 hours to build and about 600 screws. We're just 2.5 inch number 8 project screws. You use project screws, deck screws, that sort of thing. Just want to stay away from drywall screws. They're too weak for this. 2x4s, the 2x4s were used. I could have went even beefier with 2x6s, but that would be a little bit too much because I didn't want the tank to look too like beefy. I didn't want the front panel to have like a 6 inch to 10 inch like lip. Like a lot of plywood tanks, unfortunately at times they look like they're a plywood tank. And what I'd like to do is kind of try to my best to make this look like a big tank, but it's not a plywood tank. but it is 16 foot, and I think I'm gonna be able to build the whole thing for less than 1500 bucks, or at least that's what I'm on track for. I think this week we'll get the plywood, we'll install it, we'll put the first coat of epoxy down, we'll sand all the corners, we will fiberglass those, or we'll put a fiberglass cloth down, epoxy it again, and then again, and again if I have enough. Then sand all the front edges, sand the acrylic panels, silicone that in place, brace it with sticks. Plywood aquariums are abundantly easy to build. It just, there's a lot of steps, but a lot of steps means there's, you could look at it one way, there's a lot of things to mess up, but there are a lot of little things to mess up. Instead of if you're building an acrylic aquarium, which I've shown you guys countless times how to build, you get one crack at that. Glass, kind of one crack, and if you mess it up, you gotta take it completely apart, remove all the silicone, it's a nightmare. Concrete, well, I don't recommend anybody do that, but it's probably one of my favorite builds to date, simply because it was so different for me. But that is a big reason I was building this. At times, we've gotta challenge ourselves, and for somebody like me that's shown you how to build countless different types of plywood tanks, acrylic tanks, glass tanks, concrete tanks, upside down, bridges, TV tanks, you name it, every once in a while, you know, you got to dream a little bit bigger. And you might be looking at this project and think, oh, I could never do that. Yes, you can. This is super simple, super easy. And one of my favorite things is, and I'm going to be abundantly honest here, I have to stop going over here. I should have just left it out. I bought all this last year, before we even had snow. So I'm thinking October, November, just off Amazon. And then I got the acrylic probably in January, February, something like that maybe of this year. And then I got all this stuff, like you guys know, like 3 months ago I had the supplies, something like that. Anyways, what I'm getting at is everything was bought really slowly. So it doesn't even feel like I feel like I'm just putting together a free fish tank. That's the best part about plywood tanks is you can go really big. For the bigger you go, the more cost effective it is, but you don't have to buy everything at once. So it doesn't really hurt the bank that much. You're probably wondering, Joey, what are the dimensions of the tank? It is 16 feet long. It is a little over 2 feet tall, but for easier math, we're gonna get gallons. I don't think I know the gallons. So 16 feet long. It is, we'll call it 24 inches tall and 32 inches wide. So you got my length by my width by my height, in no specific order, just in inches. And we're gonna divide that by 231 because there's 231 cubic inches to a gallon. So it's 53 gallons. That makes no sense. Let me go over that again. I didn't do that. So it's 192 inches long. I said it was 16 inches long. This is my 16 foot 50 gallon tank. It's 192 inches long by 24 inches tall by 32 inches wide. Boom, divided by 231. Bam, that makes more sense. So about 640 gallons. Or if you guys want, we can call it a 638.337662. Or I can get the fire department to come over and meter this, because if I get my calculations wrong, I don't know what size my tank is, but we'll call it about a 640. And I like that size, but obviously that's not how much water it would actually hold. We'd have to measure the internal dimensions, which I'd say is probably 500 gallons. I mean, somebody else could do the math, but it's probably around 500 gallons in there. But that's how all aquariums are measured, is based on air displacement, not their metered volume. For example, a 75 gallon, which is 4 feet long, 18 inches wide, 21 inches tall, is 75 gallons, but the internal dimensions are 47 by 23, and you might only put 20 inches of water, so technically it only holds like maybe 56 gallons. You get the idea. That's how that works. And it's a great idea to know how many gallons you have. So for stocking with water dilution, filtration, water flow, turnover rates, and that sort of thing. So when you are really gonna build everything, a lot of the times you can measure the outside and you get that big, exciting number. But a lot of the times we only have to worry about the inside. The only downside to assuming your tank is bigger than it is there's a couple of things. You might, if I called this a 640, I would stock it like a 640, assuming that's how much water volume I have, when I really only have maybe 450, 500, something like that. And then I might have filtration or water pumps or wave makers or that sort of thing where I'm overspending when I don't need to. And a lot of people can say, well, you can never have too much filtration. That's a topic for another day, because in my opinion, technically you can, but that has a lot, everything to do with contact time with the bacteria, water flow, the direction of the water, how fast it's going through it, etc. But and of course, wasting your money. I don't know how we'll filter this just yet, but honestly, I have a bunch of really big canister filters kicking around, like the Eheim 2262s, some FX6s. I might toss them on it. I don't know. There's no real room under it for a sump, so I knew that going into this, I'd probably do some sort of trickle tower right beside it and or toss canister filters on it, which to me, based on the stocking, is going to be just fine. Anyways, let me know what you think about this aquarium. It's coming along. And I absolutely love it. So let me know if you do as well. I'll see you guys in the next video. And I'm going to try to upload more than once a month. I'm trying. See you in the next one.